So packaging must be suitable for sale directly to users without repackaging. Consists of at least two different articles, so you must have two articles. And this is the key, guys. Good must be put together to meet single particular need or single specific activity. And this is where it's vague, because I think there was an example in the explanatory notes where there was a, so you bring in like one of those gift baskets with cookies, cheese, and wine. Mm-hmm. You can make an argument that you're gonna consume that. You're gonna drink wine, you're gonna eat cheese, right? But actually, this is not type of activity which is. Do you particularly need to have a cookie when you drink wine? Well, I mean, I'm not an expert in the wine drinking activities, but you can. I eat cookies with a tea, okay, or biscuits. Specific activity. Usually, if you look at it, wine drinking activity, if it takes in a social place or some kind of gathering or at home to do something, or maybe to eat dinner by yourself with the meat, I do not know. But it does not necessarily have to go with the cookie. It may go with the cheese, that's arguable, right? But cookies, you can eat biscuits separately. So this is where this is again where there is no like solid line to be driven. Usually customs will tell you. So think about the stapler set, right? You have a stapler remover, stapler, and staples. Particular need, staple it. Specific activity, if I mess up and I want to take staples out, I take it out, right? So this is like no question, right? But wine with the cheese, with the biscuits, is a whole another affair. You have to actually look at authority, as they said. And the way customs will test you is they will be that authority on the exam, and in the fact pattern, they will actually give you clues of what kind of presumptions you will need to adopt. So keep that in mind. Here is an example where sandwich made with beef with or without cheese in a bun, packaged with potato chips. Okay, the question is, bun is 1602 and a French fries, potato chips, French, okay, potato French fries, okay, 2004. Do you classify them together or separately? Well, normally, if you go to Subway, right, or Panera Bread or wherever, right, they will ask you, apple or chips? Usually, it means that it become part of a norm that you eat sandwich and then you have chips on the side, at least in this culture, right? So they say, okay, potato chips go together with a bun, so it's a set. So can you classify? Do you need to break out separate classification? No, because it's the same activity. You have quick lunch. And quick lunch usually includes chips on the side, or potato chips or French fries on the side, or McDonald's, right? I always go to McDonald's, and if I am in McDonald's, I usually get a Big Mac. They always I don't like French fries because they're too salty. They always ask me a question, just a sandwich or a meal? And by meal, of course, they're asking, do I want French fries, and do I want a drink? Okay, this is just a classic example. Hair dressing set. Well, that's also a no-brainer. Scissors, electrical clippers, and a brush. Drawing kit. Okay, that's more out there, but It's also calculation instruments. Okay, so hang in there. We just got through the most difficult part. Okay, now the GRI. Once you get to GRI 3C, it's easier. So if you are in the world of GRI 3C, that means you're dealing with the question. Well, you have composite goods or several components, or the set, right? And you do not know how you should classify. You have different headings given. What do I do? And I think they're all the same. So in this example, we have, right, we have a 3-in-1 car cleaner. And you put that on top of, on that end, you put that on that end, and you use that to take the frost out of the car, to clean up the windshield, basically for the activity of car maintenance before you go out on the road. So you have a brush, you have a squeegee, and you have a scraper. And they're sold together. If you go to auto store, you can find them sold together in this big plastic blister package. And if you work for that, let's say, Advanced Auto Parts or whatever, AutoZone or whoever. By the way, I see them hiring import compliance specialists recently. They constantly do that. And the reason maybe for constantly is because they have, maybe they have a turnover, but because maybe they constantly face this type of question, which is kind of hard to determine. So people can get anxiety and just leave the job. But if you get it down, for you, it will be easier. Because as long as you're reasonable and you can make that determination, a job like that is a perfect place for you. And they're always out there. So you know that classification here is different. Not at the heading level as well as at the subheading level. So what do you do? You pick the last one. You don't think. They're the same. They cost the same. They are for the same use. So you classify each one, and you pick the last number, which in here would be 8550 brush. Right? 8050, yes. So it's a little difference there. Make sense? Last one in numerical order. But notice our discussion before we got to here, we had to figure out first GRI 1, notes, heading notes, chapter notes, section notes. Then if that didn't work, like in our example with a windshield, we have to engage in GRI 3, which one is more specific, or this one, which one is more specific, like shaver. And then if we can figure out, we have to ask, what's the essential character? And only if we cannot figure out the essential character, and in the customs exam setting, it will be probably stated that no essential characters can be given. Only then we can come here. Notice that we skip GRI 2 because we didn't deal with incomplete or disassembled articles. But if we were, we would also ask ourselves the essential character. So GRI 2 is kind of separate thing as GRI 3. But usually GRI 1 and GRI 3 requires analysis together. And is it oftentimes when you're going to do classifications, by the way, I have a bunch of classification questions for you this week. You're going to love it. You always keep that in the back of the mind. What legitimacy do you have to classify it there? So that's for GRI 3. GRI 4. This is an oddball, okay? Goods, this is what it says, GRI 4. Goods which cannot be classified in accordance with the above rules shall be classified under the heading appropriate to the goods to which they are akin. I think I've seen one question on GRI 4 in the past 5 or 7 years. And just think about this. You can pretty much classify anything under the GRI rule 1 through 3 because you have this thick book which covers a lot of things. And if that book happens to cover one thing in several places, you use GRI 3. But it is, remember this other provision, right? Other articles over. This is like a catch-all provision which can cover many things. So GRI 4 means that you cannot even classify it according to other. And what could that be? I don't know. You have use, you have make, you have pretty much all the listing of the materials. It's tough. I haven't seen so what I've seen, the one time I can recall that I've seen it, is they actually give you the statement, and in the answer choice they say to which rule this statement refers to, and they give you 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So what you do is you pick 4. So keep that in mind. I haven't seen the meritorious questions, meaning they give you the product and they say this is GRI 4. And frankly, when I looked at the customs precedent, where the argument, there was an argument made, I last week I came across it, umbilical cord. Umbilical cord is a type of connector, which is a downhole used for offshore oil exploration. So you have a rig here, right? And it has a line and it drills oil, right? And this umbilical cord is actually used to connect the machinery, such as blowout preventer valve and etc. And that umbilical cord carries the electrical wiring, it carries the fluids to make the grease, it carries just a bunch of other things, okay? And there is no classification for umbilical cord. So one attorney tried to make an argument, oh, this is GRI-4, okay? It's not anywhere provided. And customs says, no, look, you have fluids within umbilical cord carried by the hoses. So you have hose provision. You have electricity, electric controls, carried by the cords, right? So you have a cords provision, right? Electrical wiring provision, right? And this is really the question of GRI-3C. You know, all of them are important, right? The cords and the hoses and electrical wiring. So all of them are important. So you go with the last one. So you use GRI-3C. So this is a most recent example where an attorney failed in his quest for the GRI-4. And what he was trying to say is, I think he was trying to make an argument that since it's nowhere provided, this is akin to the downhole equipment. There is a provision for the downhole equipment. And they said, no, downhole, before you get to downhole, you must have it other. And you couldn't get it to other because there were cords and hoses. So again, very rare and almost never seen on a customs examination. But if asked, keep in mind, if it's impossible to classify anywhere in a GRI, this is your choice. Okay, this is a good one. So we actually touched upon this earlier today. I remember that set with the stapler, staple remover, and the staples. It was packaged in a plastic box. And you may have noticed that I never asked whether you need to break out the plastic box that those things are enclosed to. So let's see. Mm-hmm. Here. So I don't know if you can see it well, but it's a plastic box packaging, right? So I only talk about stapler. I talk about the stapler remover. But notice there are several more components here. Notice there is a marketing sheet, right? The piece of paper that says office set, Let me make it a little bigger. Okay. Can everyone see? It's offset. Well, it's printed to it's a printable paper, probably. Could be plastic, but most likely paper. And it's enclosed in a rigid plastic core. You can see it on the side here, right? This is how they pull together. It's see-through plastic molding, right? Molded material. And we are accustomed to seeing this. If you go to any like Office Depot or any supply store, Office Max, you will see those all the time. This is how they package in plastic see-through material. So the question is when we discussed, why have I never asked about packaging? Because there is not two more possible candidates besides those three items. We have a printable matter, which is this marketing sheet, classified in chapter 49. Never talked about it. And there is this plastic package, which is probably classified as 3921, which provides for articles of plastics made for conveyance or packing of goods. So I see some questionable eyes. So let me pin it down. Let me go to 39. Open a new tab. There you go. 3% duty. So that plastic box I told you would be classified probably somewhere here. Articles for packing of goods of plastics. Boxes, cases, crates, and similar articles. It will probably be there. Why have I never mentioned this during our discussion of general rule of interpretation 3? Well, the reason is because the boxes and the packing is dealt under separate GRI, which is called general rule of interpretation number 5. Can I erase it? GRI 5 deals with packaging. Okay, so let's see what it says. Oops. Let's see. So it says, it gives you a list of packaging materials. So it starts with the camera cases, musical instrument cases, a gun cases, drawing instrument cases, necklace cases, and similar containers, specially shaped or fitted, this is the key, specially shaped or fitted, to contain a specific article or set of articles, suitable for long-term use, and entered with the articles for which they are intended, shall be classified with such articles when of a kind normally sold therewith. In other words, if it comes packaged and it's pre-shaped like we saw with that set, where you had special plastic packaging with a pop-out for the stapler, pop-out for the stapler remover, etc., etc. It is specially made container. It is probably not suitable for long term, but we'll talk about that in a bit. It's entered with that package, with that stapler set. And it because it's normally sold with that, you normally don't take it out and sell it separately. Although you can, I've seen dollar store, 99 cent store places doing that. Then, most likely, you classify it with that item. So let's look at the provision B. Subject to the provision of the rule for way, so subject to the exception, okay? Packing materials and containers, when brought together with the product, shall be classified with the goods if they are of a kind normally used for packing of such goods. However, this provision is not binding when such packaging material, packing containers, are clearly suitable for repetitive use. For repetitive use, is that blister package, plastic package, suitable for repetitive use? Well, possibly, right? But most likely you're gonna cut the stuff out and throw it away, right? I just take my razor blade out, get the stapler, get the staples, get the staple remover, and throw that useless piece of plastic. So, what's a repetitive use? Repetitive use is it normally the type of stuff that you normally use it? Okay, normally use it repetitively. And again, there is no clear answer. You have to look around and figure it out. So, if it's not suitable for repetitive use, it's classified together with the goods or they're normally sold with, okay? It doesn't really have to be suitable for long-term use. It does not have to be suitable for long-term use, all right? So that means that that plastic container, by virtue of general rule 5, does not need, is entered together with article, it does not need to be classified separately. You do not need to classify it whatsoever, you don't worry about it. You pretend like it's a case, okay? It's just there. So that's the set. But let me take a short pause and talk about the provision which is the suitable use. One example of suitable for repetitive use would be the gas canisters. The ones you see in gas stations, or the big ones, there is the small ones for the propane, and there are big ones for carriage, okay? They're clearly containers. And when you bring them into the country, you're not bringing them because they are containers, even though they may be costly, whatever. You're getting them in because you bring in the gas. So you're classifying them as the gas. You're classifying it as CO2 or methane or whatever. But should you break out the container separately? Normally, no. But it's beyond my imagination that once you use that gas, because it's so bulky and so expensive, are you going to fill it up again and use it again? And I do not know how many of you used that when we went out camping or for whatever reason, or seen trucks carrying those big canisters, okay, the gas tanks. I'm sure you have no question that they are suitable for many times. It's not just like a lighter. They use it and throw it away. They're going to refill it up, okay? So this is a type of situation where customs may say, oh, no, this you must classify this as a gas tank and that as a gas. But it's a discretionary. So, and this is the reason why it's not binding. It doesn't say it's a must. It doesn't say it's required, you have to do this. It's discretionary, it's a possibility, it's not binding. Not binding means customs or the port director have a discretion. And there was yeah.
So, the GRI 5 physically is not binding?
No, GRI 5
binding.
Is binding, it's binding, but GRI 5, you cannot think of GRI 5 as one thing. Kind of like with GRI 3, you have different type of products, right? Depending on which one you deal with it, the only criteria for GRI 3, it must be in different heading, classifiable in different headings. That's the only criteria. GRI 5, again, when you have a question from customs examiners saying, should the container be classified with that product, or should it not be classified, should be classified as a separate thing? This is when you go to GRI-5 to think about it. So this is your principles. They are way, they are broadly written. They can cover almost anything. All right?
So, example, if the importer bring in the musical instrument with the, not only with the packing, but with the case, like, so the case is applied into the GRI 5.
Here is one, jewelry boxes and cases, electric shaver cases, binocular cases, telescope cases. They are nice telescope cases. This is not the cheap stuff like this, right? They are nice ones. They can cost you a lot of money. If it's a nice binocular, they have specially fitted padding. The case itself is very rigid. It can cost by itself a lot of money, right? And depending on electric shaver, I'm not using that, so I'm not, I cannot have any comments on this one. But musical instrument cases, yeah, they can also be expensive, depending on the instrument, right? Gun cases, if you have some kind of antique gun that you store and you carry it, it's you sometimes carry it in a nice case, sometimes with the engraving, and the case sometimes even can be as expensive as the gun. It can have like gold outlay.
So they bring it here with the border is free.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So in those situations, you never classify the case, and where would you classify the case? Chapter 42. Right? Chapter 42 is for containers and the cases. Sometimes if it's plastic, like the one I talked about, that's very simple stuff, it's chapter 39. But most of the time it's chapter 42. So let me, here I go with a extrapolation. So if container is specifically specially shaped and fitted, okay, it is classified. So shape and fitting, and those are the factors. The container must be designed specifically to accommodate the article. So that blister package was designed to specifically accommodate those staples, staple remover, and staples. Durability. Now, notice on durability. Durability must be comparable to that of the article for which the container is intended. So if I'm bringing the staple, staple remover, and staples, what am I going to do? I'm just going to take it out and throw it away, most likely. So do I need a very nice container for that stapler? Probably not, if I'm just going to use it only once. So it is a cheap plastic molding. But if I'm having the antique gun, which cost $50,000 or more, I may have a golden decorated box to because it's a presentable piece. It's an antique. It's a collection. So it makes sense. But would you import the nice golden box, gold with laid with a golden clad for stapler? Probably not, because stapler is something you use as a utility. For example, if you have a Parker pen, you have a nice wooden box with some kind of engraving. But do you ever find that with this type of ballpoint pen which is sold in packages? This is sold in plastic. So if you try to bring this type of pen in a nice box, can you, like a Parker box, right? Parker pen box. You bring in the, it's a Pilot pen, okay? So Pilot makes common use general public pens. You bring it in a Parker box. Most likely you will have to classify that box separately, because this is not the type of marketing or distribution practice which is commonly accepted. In customer's mind, what they're thinking is you're trying to elude or go around of paying duties. Because, remember I mentioned chapter 42? Let's just check it out and see what type of duties they're covering. So take a look. So you have, let me make it a little bigger. So one thing, you have school cases that are 8% if they made with leather, right? But if they have plastic or textile, they go immediately to 20% duty.